Okay, hello. So I'm going to talk about output sparse Gaussian processes, and I'm going to introduce a new concept of sparse kernels. Okay, as a motivation, so there are these things called zero-inflated learning problems, where we basically have data which are sparse, but they have quantitative effects, events. So basically we need to learn a regression function where we have an overabundance of zeros in the outputs. So for example, we could have some ecological data sets where we have, for example, fish eggs or fish abundances in the sea. Most regions are completely devoid of the species, and then somewhere we do have some quantitative amount of the fish. And also forest fires are quite sparse events. However, the event itself is still quantitative, so we could, for example, look at the how long does the forest fire burn at a certain location. And here again, we might assume that there is some smoothness here. So the nearby locations probably have similar outputs. So this is basically a problem where we combine aspects of classification, so whether the signal is zero or non-zero, and regression, which is the signal magnitude. And in statistics, these have been considered quite a lot as hurdle models or zero-inflated models or beta processes and so forth, but not much in machine learning. Okay, so this sounds like a perfect case to apply sparsity. So we have lots of sparse methods, for example, Lasso, Horseshoe, ARD, Spike and Slab. But these are all methods that design sparsity over the input domain. So we have sparse features, not sparse outputs. That is what we actually want. There's an interesting approach of the structural Spike and Slab where the sparse regions are correlated. So you have similar locations are usually put to zero together. So instead, what we propose is smooth signals with smooth sparsity. And Gaussian processes are really nice models to handle anything where you have any smooth functions. So I'm going to introduce GPs quickly. So GPs are basically distributions over functions. So we have a function prior that basically encodes that similar points give similar outputs. So for any number of function outputs f, the distribution is Gaussian, where the covariance is exactly the function the input kernel similarities. So here at the bottom we see some realizations from Gaussian process prior with a kernel, and now we can condition these by some inducing landmark points where we know the function value. So this just becomes a Gaussian conditional where we have a posterior mean and a posterior covariance, or just interpolation mean interpolation covariance. And at the bottom we see how adding these landmark points or inducing points has contracted this distribution. And we can also see the posterior covariance, where the diagonal shows the variances, and the couple blue regions show negative correlation around the first inducing point. Okay, so Gaussian processes in general don't work with zero-inflated data. So here we see an example where we have data where in the y-axis there's lots of stuff around zero. So we could think that those are sort of like off regions for this signal. And then we have the actual signal that is the regions away from zero. So GPs don't really work here. So we clearly need something else. So this is what we propose. We propose zero-inflated Gaussian processes where we clearly need two functions. We need the latent or signal function f, and we need the sparsity or the filter or the masking function g, which defines whether the function is on or off. And what we propose is to encode this sparsity directly into the covariance of the latent function f. So this is the key thing here. We have the standard kernel k, which is the function f smooth kernel, and we also have the g function through some link function, in this case a appropriate CDF, that then sparsifies the kernel. So let's see how this looks like. So here is an animation. So we start by having a smooth sparsity GP. So that's at the bottom. So it's basically just a score of whether the signal is on or off at the input locations on the x-axis. Then we squash this by normal CDF. So we basically have a probit model. So now it's between 0 and 1. So we clearly see that we have 0 regions and 1 regions. And we still have a nice covariance model coming from the Gaussian process as well. Then we construct a probit sparsified kernel. So we take an outer product between the CDF and itself. So this gives basically this kind of mask where the yellow regions are 1 and the dark blue regions are 0. Now we can look at the actual latent signal kernel, which is just a smooth Gaussian kernel. We take a Hadamard product between those two guys, so we get this kind of interesting sparsified kernel where certain rows and columns are zeroed out, which means that you have zero variance. So then we of course revert back to the mean, which in this case is designed to be zero, and that's where you get the sparsity. So in the end, this is the final predictive function. So we now have a system where we can learn both the underlying signal and also the on-off regions. And now the key question here is now, how do we learn the F and G functions in this kind of hierarchical Gaussian process model? So we revert to variational inference, as many others. So we first introduce some inducing variables, both for the sparsity and for the latent function. So these are the sort of support points that support the function surfaces. We would like to optimize matching likelihood. So that is the expected fit of the data under some prior distribution. So in the expected likelihood or the matching likelihood, we want to optimize the likelihood y given f and g, where we draw matchlines away all f and g given some hyperparameters. So this is a nice quantity to optimize because it doesn't overfit, or in general it doesn't overfit. However, in general it's non-tractable. So in a Gaussian process setting, the variation inference was derived by Hensman, or the current version that people use a lot, was derived by Hensman in 2013. So here we have the evidence lower bound or the elbow. So it decomposes into two parts. So we have the KL term between the variational prior and the true prior of the inducing points. And then we have the more interesting term, which is the expected log likelihood, where we have to take the expectation over the variational distributions. And then there is again this connection that the matching likelihood log py equals the elbow plus a KL divergence between the variational posterior and the true posterior. So because the matching likelihood is constant, that means that when the elbow goes up, the KL part goes down, so then we get closer to the true posterior with our variational posterior. Okay, so this was all sort of the theoretical motivation, and then in practice what we have to do is to solve these integrals. So we now have to compute this expected log likelihood, where we now have to integrate out the signal variable f, the sparsity variable g, the inducing points for both, and assuming Gaussian variation distributions. And this actually can be done. So this is the final form of the elbow when we integrate out these guys. However, we are not completely there yet, so there are these interesting terms here sort of remain that we still need to solve. So it seems that we have some second moments that that emerge in the elbow, and these seem difficult to solve, but actually there are solutions for all of these using standard Gaussian integrals where we have the normal CDFs and then this new function, Owen's T function, that hasn't seen much use before in variational inference. So we can actually compute the expected probit, the expected probit square and the variance of the probit using these quantities. So basically this output sparse Gaussian process has a tractable variational bound. So that's nice. Okay, so then for a couple of experiments. So here is one experiment where this zero inflated Gaussian process works quite nicely. So we have rain data. So we have an hourly rainfall measurements, zero or positive, from 105 weather stations for 1 month in Finland. And we have some 100,000 data points. So we here included a bit of spatiotemporal Kronecker kernels as well. So here at the top, we see some of the data going through hourly progression. So the red points are heavy rain. At the bottom, we see the sparsity function. So this defines where we have rain at all. So it's sort of like a cloud function. And in the middle, we see the rainfall amount function where we condition on the G. So it seems to work quite nicely. We also did some results or tables where we can assess how well this thing compares to the previous approaches. So we can improve both sort of the regression aspect of minimizing the mean square error, and we can also improve on the classification aspect of finding the zeros and non-zeros, which we measure by the F1. Okay, but we are not actually that interested in solving rainfall datasets and such. We are actually interested in applying this output sparse Gaussian process in latent models. And that's what we are going to do next. So we are going to add sparsity to the Gaussian process regression network framework, which is a multitask Gaussian process learning framework by Wilson, 2013. So the idea here is that we have multiple outputs. In this case, we have three outputs in the example. And we assume that there's a shared underlying latent signal or functions from which we can reconstruct each of the outputs using mixing functions. So in this example, we have two latent signals we need to learn. We have three outputs. Each output uses both of the latent signals through mixing matrices. So we have six of these mixing functions. And we need to learn here both the latent functions, the shared underlying representation, and the mixing functions. So 8 Gaussian processes in total for this example. Now the key problem here is that by design, this system is actually fully dense. So we actually mix all latent signals with all outputs. So it's a fully dense system because the GPs can, I mean, these are standard GPs, so they can sort of hover around zero, but not exactly zero. So we obviously add the sparsity here. So the way we do it is that we add the sparsity to the mixing functions. So the idea is that the latent signals are still dense or whatever they are, but we reconstruct the outputs using sparse mixing so we can choose which of the latent signals we use for which outputs. So here the mixing function W is now conditioned on this sparsity function G. And now this causes the inputs and outputs to be adaptively coupled. So here's an example. This is the Jura dataset, which is a 2D dataset. So we basically have spatial data. And then we have measurements of three different, metals in the ground. So we have cadmium, nickel, and zinc on the right. So that's the data. And we defined two latent functions. And then because we mix from two latent to three outputs, we have six mixing matrices. So when we predict the posterior of the cadmium, we now take the first latent function, the green guy, with the green mixing function, and basically take a Hadamard product of these two guys. Then we take a Hadamard product of the second latent function and the second mixing function, which is the red guys. And then we get the black stuff. And we can do the same thing for all of these. And now the key thing here is that the white regions in the mixing functions are zero. So it means that, for example, when we predict the cadmium, the first latent signal is not used at all on the top left region of the space. So it basically ignores that. So it only uses the second latent signal over there. So we can decouple latents and outputs. And each output can use a subset of latent inputs. Okay, now one could ask, okay, this is nice, it might improve the interpretability, but is this actually beneficial for prediction? Before that, there's also this decomposition of the latent weights and sparsity masks, but this is pretty basic stuff. So here's some results from this system. So at the bottom in the middle, we see the standard Gaussian process network and the sparse network with respect to training errors when we increase the number of inducing points. So when we make the variational approximation better and better. And both of them go down nicely, that's nice. Now, with respect to test errors, so the black, the red curve is the baseline, the dense model. So it seems that the red model actually tends to increase error when we increase the number of inducing points. So it starts to overfit. And the orange curve is the sparse network test error. So it seems to slightly improve or just stay stable. So it seems to be more resistant to overfitting and seems to be more resistant to adding more inducing points. So this is good news. Okay, and then just I'm going to quickly show this variational bound for this sparse GP network. So here is the whole thing. It's quite a beast. So basically it's just mechanical, mechanically solving multivariate Gaussian integrals from, I mean, basically handbooks. And now here I would just like to maybe add a comment that we do have the autodiff, which is really, really cool for optimization. But when we derive variational bounds, it would also be nice to have some kind of auto int to get these integrals solved automatically, because this is just mechanical stuff. So I know that there are symbolic math packages that can do something, but I don't know. I don't know if anything that actually can work in this scale. Okay, so as a conclusion, we basically propose output sparse Gaussian processes with profit sparse wide kernels, and we demonstrate that this is all tractable and analytical with respect to various inference. And these can be used as plugin modules in various frameworks. And in future, we are interested in working with compressive sensing, which is when we observe a low-dimensional data and we need to reconstruct a high-dimensional model using heavy sparsity assumptions. And also Bayesian optimization might be interesting. We could have a fitness function which just breaks down for wrong configuration, something like that. So that would be on off. Okay, thank you.